right. Good morning, Journey Church. I love it. Love to hear the sound of everybody fellowshipping, getting to know one another. Good morning. Great to see all of you this morning. If you're visiting, welcome you. My name is Vic. It's great to have you with us this morning. In just a moment, we're going to receive the Sunday morning offering. If you're a visitor, inside your bulletin, you'll notice there's a little slip in there. Take that out and fill that out and just drop that in the offering. That's really all that we ask of you this morning. For those of us who call Journey home, this is an opportunity for us to worship God, give, and to be a part of what He's doing in our city and throughout the world. On these cards, there's a little place in the bottom that says prayer requests. If you have a prayer request for anything, I want to encourage you to write that down, drop it in the offering. We actually have a prayer team, a prayer group that's going to start meeting and praying for all different kinds of things. But one of the things they will do is cards and be praying for you, whatever situation is going on. So if you have any prayer requests, drop those off in the offering, and we'll be lifting you up this week. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward this morning. We want to continue to remember that we are not we are not the church. We are a gathering of the church that all of the believers in Jacksonville and throughout the world. So we often pray for other congregations during this time. And so I want to pray for River City Church this morning, which meets over in the South Point. Pray for them and for their pastor and all that God is doing in and through that congregation. So as we pray over the offering, let's pray for them as well. Let's pray. God, thank you for blessing ways. God, we're fortunate people. Just to be able to come through these doors this morning and be here is a blessing. And so we thank you for that. Thank you for providing for us in many ways. Thank you that you allow us that we might be able to give back to you. And so God, as we do that this morning, receive this as our worship to you. God, just taking the gifts that you've given to us and giving them back to you to be used, to be a blessing to the world. And it's our prayer that that's what would take place. As these gifts are given, God, needs would be met, lives would be touched, the gospel would be shared with people, and God, the world would be different as a result. And we thank you for it. And God, we pray for our brothers and sisters over at River City Church, and we thank you for them and all that you're doing in and through that congregation. Pray for Pastor Antley there. With your spirit, use him this morning, God. Meet every need that they have in that congregation and continue to use them to be a blessing right where they're at throughout the city. And God, we just thank you. Thank you that we have brothers and sisters all around the city gathered. And God, we're not alone. And we thank you for that, that we're a part of something much bigger. And help us to see that. We thank you for it all, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, a couple of announcements. Before we get started this morning, we have a Guatemala mission trip coming up at the end of October. If you're interested in that, sign up out in the cafe. We're kind of coming down to the wire there. So if you're thinking about that, sign up. If you're interested but don't have the funds, I encourage you to sign up and just see what God might do to provide for you in that. Some of the other announcements you can see in there on the right side of the bullet, announcement for a partnership class. This is basically the next step. If you've been coming to Journey, hanging out for a little while, you feel like this may be your home, at least for the next season of time, come out to our partnership class. You can sign up out in the cafe for that. It's a time where we talk about really our heart and our vision. You meet some of the leaders. It's an opportunity for you to interact and really just, okay, this is where God has me during this time. I want to partner together with this body of believers to do what God's called us to do in this city and throughout the world. So if that's where you're at, I encourage you to come out to that. And lastly, the children's ministry. I talked about this a little bit at the end of the service last week. And just an opportunity to serve and be a blessing to our community here. So if you have kids that are being served back there, we really ask that you at least serve once a month. But if you just want to be a blessing, just want to help out, whether it's or teaching the children's church or help with youth, we would welcome that. There's always a need. You can talk to Shantae, Lori, or Julie about that, and they're usually out at the well, I would encourage you to do that. I'm going to have a guest come up and share a little bit this morning. Over the last few weeks, we've talked a lot about globally. We had the boys from Guatemala here, and that's the heart of Journey Church, is really to be the church, which is the family of God living on mission. Jesus gave us that command, the mission, to go and make disciples of all nations. So we do that here, and we do it globally. And so there's a lot of things going on that a lot of us aren't maybe aware of when we connect with here at Journey and even in our own city. So I'm going to ask Mark Nettleton to come up. And Mark, wow, you got fans, brother. Mark is going to talk a little bit about a ministry called Second Mile. It's a ministry that we've partnered with over the last few years, and he's going to share a little bit of what they do and what they're doing. It's Mark.
Thanks, Vic. So that this, you know, doesn't go on for half an hour. So thanks for having me here. We've been partnering with Journey for probably 3 or 4 years with Second Mile Ministries, but I've never had the chance to come. I've actually recommended your church to strangers before, yet I've never been here, so I'm glad in the future, if I meet someone, I can do that a little more confidently. But I love what you have going on. I'm a big fan of Journey. But anyway, so Second Mile Ministries, I'm the Director of Advancement for Second Mile, and we are a Christian community development ministry focused on the Brentwood. So if you don't know where Brentwood is, if this is Jacksonville, right, this is the St. John's River. Downtown is on the north bank, directly north of downtown. We have the Springfield neighborhood. Directly north of Springfield is Brentwood. And in Brentwood, otherwise you might know Pearl Street is the main road that runs through our neighborhood, is where we're focused. And our mission is this, is we're seeking to see the gospel renew lives and communities so that we're in every way. And Brentwood is, statistically, if you look at a map, we are a glowing red dot, whether that be in economically, education, crime, communities. So for us, oftentimes what we run into is that people in Brentwood see two options for their lives. One is you're going to settle for what already exists, and two is you're going to escape this neighborhood and never look back and pretend like it didn't happen to me. But we want to present a third option, and the third option would be to say, I'm going to be a disciple of Christ and a transformative leader from and for my who's here to bring the transformative work of the gospel in my neighborhood and in my family, in my school, in my workplace, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So what that looks like for us is, well, one, I guess a real example of that is right now we have an intern who's working with us, and he grew up in Brentwood. His name's Ernest, and on a daily basis, I see him do things I can't do. And he does things better than I can do, even though I've got a college degree, 5 years of experience, etc. Every day, I see him do something, say something to a kid, do things in a way different from it, and that is better than how I would do it. So our goal is to see a whole neighborhood of Ernests brought up, following Christ and leading others the same way. So it starts at age 5 and runs all the way up to adult. We have an after-school program, a middle school program, a summer day camp. And then most excitingly, next Sunday will mark the one-year anniversary of Northside Community Church, which I'm this week because if you would ask me to come next week, I would be at the one-year anniversary of Northside Community Church. So that's led by Pastor Aaron Mitchell. I could talk about Pastor Aaron forever, but he's also a great people from the community who intuitively understand how to bring transformation. And the end goal of all this is what we want. The end goal is that we would have a neighborhood that radiates the glory of God. That it wouldn't be that when you hear Brentwood, you wouldn't think, oh, that's that bad neighborhood, or oh, that's that place I heard about on the news, but that people would say, that is a community where there is a God who loves people and is working huge transformation in their lives. So that would be what we see and think when we hear about the Brentwood neighborhood or Pearl Street, because there is a God who loves these huge work in our lives at Journey Church on the north side, on the south side, all over Jacksonville. He's doing that. So we want to be a part of that. So that's what we're about. One quick thing is on May 5th, that is Second Mile's biggest event of the year. It's our Family Fall Festival. About 1,000 people will show up at this event, and it's a safe family event for people to come out to, which is rare in our neighborhood. So as we do that, we need two things. We need candy and we need cars. So in the past Journey, you have collected candy. If people want to donate candy, that would be great to do that again. also have a trunk or treat as a part of the event where people bring out their car and run a game out of it or do whatever. So if you're interested in either of those things, in volunteering or that, I will be out there at the end. If you have other questions, if you want to hear anything else, you know, I don't know, jokes, something, I'll be out at the end of the service. But thanks for worship with you. It's really a joy and an honor to be here. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks, Mark. I just love the fact that God allows us to be part of stuff like that in our city. That we can come alongside of them and give and help. And a number of in the past, they have a summer camp that they do. People have volunteered down there. And so if you have any interest in hearing more, talk to Mark. We will be collecting candy. So it'll be an opportunity for you to be a blessing. Bringing some candy, being a blessing to what they're doing down there. And it just made me think when Mark was talking about that community and living in that community, it just reminded me of John chapter 1, the very beginning. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, speaking of Jesus. And then you drop down into the latter part, and the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. Or the Message Bible puts it this way, and the Word became flesh and moved into the neighborhood. God stepping out of His world into ours because He loved us, because He wanted to show that love tangibly. And that's what's happened down there. So you got people moved into that neighborhood purposefully to share the love of Jesus with them. And how awesome it is to be able to come alongside what they're doing. Now a church is being birthed out of there. And it's really cool. Here's the thing, you don't have to move to Brentwood. You do that right where you're at. Whatever neighborhood you're in, you say, well, there's not that kind of need in my neighborhood. Well, there might not be that kind of outward need where you see people without clothing and food. But listen, there's a lot of starving souls out there. There's a lot of starving souls, people who are just longing to know that they're loved. We talked about this last week. If you weren't here, we talked about the fact that the greatest need that we have as human beings, outside of just our physical needs of water, air, our greatest need, I really believe, is to be loved. And there's so many people who don't know that they're loved. And we have the ability to bring love to them. Just to share what we've found. But the key is we have to have it first, right? So we were singing that song this morning, that beautiful song at the end. And it is well with my soul. And I was just sitting there thinking, you know, you can take all these notes that I got for this morning and scrap them. And the most important thing is that we all know that it's well with our soul. And I want you to think about that this morning. Are you in that place where you can honestly say, okay, it's okay. I mean, my relationship with God, it's okay. I'm where I need to be. I know that I'm His child. I know that I'm His son, that I'm His daughter. Are you there this morning? And if not, it's my hope that by the time you leave here, you will be there. So we've been talking about what it means to be the child. Talking about the church being a body, not an institution, not a building, but a body of believers gathered together. And last week, we read this passage out of 1 Peter, where he was talking about how we are all gifted by God, and those gifts are to be used for His glory. And I'm just going to read through this again, just as a review. 1 Peter 4:7-10. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. So basically, Peter says, listen, the time is short. Okay, the end is near. The time is short. Be clear-minded. Be self-controlled. Understand what matters and what doesn't so that you know how to pray. Know how to live for His kingdom as opposed to this kingdom. And he goes, above all, above everything, love each other deeply. first and foremost, love each other. It's the same thing you heard Jesus say when the Pharisees cornered him and said, hey, what's the greatest commandment? What did he say? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and neighbor as yourself. Peter heard that, and so now he goes, listen, above all, love each other deeply. Not some sentimental, gushy, emotional love, but no, a love that serves, a love that takes action, a love that goes and serves people with no strings attached, just because it's the right thing to do. Because you've received, and it says, go and give it. And that's what Christ commanded us, and Peter's reinforcing that, and he goes, offer hospitality to one another without grumbling and complaining. Open your home to people. People over, have their feet under your table, let them get to know you, let your guard down a little bit. That's not easy for us, is it? You know, to kind of let your guard, we talked about back where, you know, unless everything's just right in the house, we don't want to have people over. You know how it is, right? You know, you got to find a place for the pile of clothes that's on the dining room table. You throw it in the master bedroom, and you hope no one accidentally walks in that door when they're over for small group or whatever it might be. Listen, we got to let our guard down a little bit. A lot people don't care as much about that as you do, probably. That's the truth. And until we do that, and we open our lives and our homes and who we are to other people, understand what this means to love each other deeply and to experience that exchange of love. And he goes on to say that we have been given gifts and we should freely use those gifts. And as we do, we administer the grace of God to one another. His grace, his love extends through us as we serve one another and use the gifts that he's given us, which is an unbelievable thing to think about, that God's love will flow through you to others. So we say, what's the most important need that we have as individuals? Well, it's to be loved, to know that we're loved. And it's amazing to think that every one of us in this room, every person on the earth, has to meet that need. If we've experienced the fullness of His love, we have that to give to people. And people are starving, they're dying without that. We need that love. And we all need to know that love so that we don't self-destruct. I heard someone say one time that basically the goal of is I have this self-destruct button, and really the goal of my life is to keep my finger off it. Now think about that for a minute. We all have this tendency towards sin, these things that are destructive in our lives, and what that self-destruct button might look like might manifest itself in addictive, it might manifest itself in other sin. We all have this tendency toward that, and we need to keep our hands off of that button, and as we experience God's love in and through other people, our tendency is to move away from that, move toward Him, and move toward the things that fill us and not the things we end up running after, which are often self-destructive, even when we don't know it or don't recognize it. So if we know Jesus, we know that love, we have something to give the world. So Paul, he writes about this in 2 Corinthians chapter. This is where we're going to spend our time this morning, is in a passage in 2 Corinthians. I want to give you some background to it because it's important to always have the context. Paul here is talking about the reality of life, the fact that life is short. He says there's going to come a day when our heaven, or when our earthly tent that we live in will be gone. When it is gone, we are going to go and we have a heavenly dwelling that's secure for us in heaven. He goes, you know, we need to understand that. There's going to be a day when the burdens of this world, and we'll be with Him, and all those burdens will be removed. So that's the backdrop of what he writes here in 2 Corinthians 5, beginning in verse 16. So thinking about that, the reality of our heavenly in this earthly world that we live in, look at verse 16. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view, though we once regarded Christ in this way. We do so no longer. Anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he's committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who is sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Let's pray. God, as we look at this passage, you give us wisdom and insight that only you can give. I pray for all of us, God, that you'd be working in our hearts by your Spirit, that you'd open the eyes of our hearts, open our ears to say to us this morning, that we would understand the gospel in a new way, and God, that through it, we would get closer to you and understand your love more and more. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so Paul leads up to this passage. He's talking about the brevity of this earthly life. He's talking about the fact that everything is going to pass away. And then in verse 16, he goes, from now we regard no one from a worldly point of view, though we once regarded Christ in this way. We do so no longer. So don't look at anyone with worldly eyes. Things differently. We need to have a different perspective. He goes, we don't want to regard anyone from an earthly point of view, even though there was a time when we looked at Jesus this way. Now, who's writing this? Paul was a persecutor of Christians. Before Paul had his encounter with Jesus, he was throwing Christians in prison. Okay, he believed that Jesus was a renegade prophet out to destroy Judaism. So Paul, being very religious, a Pharisee, one who knew the scriptures inside and out, he is hunting down Christians because he didn't believe that Jesus was the Son of God. He was looking at it from an earthly perspective. And then what happened to Paul? Paul's on his way to this place called Damascus, and all of a sudden he has an encounter. This bright light comes down, something knocks him off his horse, we don't know, knocks him to the ground and says, he hears, Saul, Saul, are you persecuting me? He's like, Lord, who are you? I'm Jesus, the one whom you're persecuting. So he has this encounter with the living God. And after that, he's radically transformed. He goes from the persecutor of Christians, one who approves of their death and murder, to the biggest proponent of the faith, the biggest evangelist, sharing this. So, Jesus changes everything in Paul's life, and he changes everything in our lives if we open our eyes to him. Okay, so he goes, don't look at people from a worldly point of view. Let me ask you this question. When you look at people, what are the first things that go through your mind? Don't say it. Because there'll be a lot of offended people, the people around here, right? I mean, what are the first things a lot of times? What people are wearing. What kind of shape they're in, right? Does that person work out? If you guys think if I'm a little bit slow today or had someone come in again. I was tired last week because I stayed up and watched that stupid Florida game. But this week, that's not the case. If I look tired and I look weak, it's because I'm 7 days into a raw vegan cleanse. All right? And so I'm 7 days in, lost 7 pounds. I feel pretty good. Anthony's shaking his head over there. And don't worry, I'm not gonna come and we're not gonna put this on you. Like, this is God's way to live. All right, everybody needs to do the Daniel fast or anything like that. Because I think this really actually may be from the devil. I was at this gathering last night, and everyone brings a dish and there's all this food on the table. And I look at it, I go, I don't think there's one thing on that table I can eat. And then there was like one of those little veggie trays with the ranch in the middle. I can't even have the ranch, you know, just the stuff around. I'm like, I think this is what hell's going to be like. Like, all this great food laid out, but you can't have any of it. You know, you can't have anything. Anyhow, sidetrack there. Sorry about that. But where was I? How did I get there? How we look. What goes through your mind when you first see people? He goes, listen, don't regard people from an earthly point of view. And this is real important for us to get. simple, very simple phrase that I want you to understand. Everything in life is spiritual. Everything in life is spiritual. You're created by God, for God. He knit you together in your mother's womb. That's what Scripture says. You're fearfully and wonderfully made. He created you with a purpose in mind to join Him in what He's doing to do something in this world. Everything about our lives is spiritual. The way that I respond and react to treat my kids and my family has a lot to do with how God is reflected in my family and how my kids will grow up to view the Father. The way you respond is the integrity that you have will speak something to people about God. They'll know that there's something different about you. And who says one thing and does another, that will reflect also on God. And that's why a lot of people are like, they tap out on this whole church thing going, listen, I don't want anything to do with that. They say they're Christians and they talk about Jesus, and then, you know, in the break room they're dropping F-bombs, there's no difference. Listen, everything in life is spiritual. Don't look at it from a worldly perspective. How do we look at it from a heavenly perspective? So it's not just my life, it's the people around me. God's working in their hearts and giving me love to show and exchange and be a blessing to the world around me. There's people who either they know God and they need to be encouraged and strengthened in their walk, or they don't know God and they're empty and they need to know that love. We talked about it a couple weeks ago, maybe it was last week, where people who don't love turn to destructive behavior. Some who even take their own lives because they just don't think that anybody loves them. And they don't think that anybody's there. And they've bought in and believed a lie. And here's the crazy paradox of that whole thing, is that not only are they loved, they actually have the ability inside themselves to help someone in that state. If they would get full and free, they have the ability within them to show love to somebody else. We all have that. So everything in life is spiritual. Listen, don't look at things from an earthly perspective. Verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. This is from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Okay. Reconciliation. We have the ministry of reconciliation. What does that mean? It says, don't look at people from a worldly perspective. Look from a heavenly perspective. Because in Jesus, all things are made new. Your new creation in Christ. The old is gone, the new has come. If you receive His love, His grace, His mercy to us in Christ and His sacrifice, we become a new creation in Christ, changed from the inside out. So, how many of you in here would say, I want you to raise your hand, but if you would say that you're a follower of Jesus, you're a Christian, okay, according to what the Scripture says, you're a new creation in Christ, do you always feel like a new creation in Christ? Do you wake up in the morning and say, praise God, I feel like a new man? Sometimes, right? Or a new woman. Sometimes. Sometimes, like, at least for me, it's like everything I do to just get out of bed, get in there, brush your teeth, and get on with the day. So what does this mean, your new creation in Christ? Because certainly everything doesn't change into a relationship with Jesus. Something changes. The Holy Spirit changes us on the inside, but everything doesn't change. When I came into a relationship with Jesus, my life was a mess. My life, some things on the outside that changed like that, and thank God for it. But what about this stuff back here? What about those of us in this room who've experienced abuse or pain? Does that all of a sudden just disappear? No. Do we all of a sudden just like, hey, get over it. You're a new person in Jesus. It doesn't work. At least it didn't for me. But now I'm a new creation. My life has changed. I look at things from a different perspective. I don't look at things from a worldly perspective. So maybe when I look back at some of the inflicted on me, I realized that some of that, not to excuse it, but some of it was because those people were people of that love. And because they didn't know that love, they responded out of their own woundedness. And we've said it before, you've heard the saying probably, hurt people, right? So listen, if you're hurt this morning, you need healing. Otherwise, you'll continue to hurt people. You need that healing. Been hurt, you need to extend that forgiveness. Not so much for them as it is for you. Because that's what brings that healing. If anyone's in Christ, he's a new creation. The new has come. This is from God who reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So through Jesus, we're reconciled. Our lives are put back in proper standing with God. It's like the relationship. He has made amends. He has atoned for our sin. All of us are sinners, separated. Jesus died for our sins. When we receive that gift, our sin is atoned for. It's taken care of. We're forgiven. So we've been reconciled. And now Paul goes, now we have this ministry of reconciliation. Well, what does that mean? That's a big word. Reconciliation. And I don't know how many of you consider yourself ministers. Remember Reed a couple weeks ago, that word ministry means to serve. He's like, you know, it's just serving behind the scenes. It's scrubbing toilets. It's just serving. So we're servants of his, ministers of reconciliation. What does that look like? Look at verse 19. This is the good news. God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. Listen, the gospel literally means good news. That's what the word means, good news. This is good news. Jesus died to take care of the sin problem in the world. For God so loved who? The world, that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever does what? Believes in him, will have eternal life. Okay? So, he died so that we might live. This is the good news. And he says, now we're ministers of reconciliation. You receive that, you internalize that, your life gets changed from the inside out, and now you share that with people. And in old school, we would say, man, you need to be evangelizing people. That word scares me. I don't know about you guys, right? Like, you need to be an evangelist. I'm like, oh, you got to get a gold watch, some big hair. What does that mean, right? And that's the problem with Christianity today, is these words mean so many different things to people, right? You say that word, some people get scared and go, that dude's out there. Because, well, what does that mean? You got a message, the message of reconciliation. There go the notes. So we'll see what happens. but here's the deal. You receive that. I am the furthest person from being a good salesman. Okay? Some people, man, they could sell ice to an Eskimo. They're just like, man, that's just their deal. I'm not a salesman. That's not my personality. So like my personality wouldn't be that outward like evangelist. Some people say, Vic, you know, you're talking about gifting. That's not my gifting. I'm not an evangelist, right? Neither. But if I go to a good restaurant and they serve me one of those sandwiches that's like that big, right now I'd probably run away because I can't eat it. But they serve one of those sandwiches that's like that big and you can only eat half of it. I'm calling up my friends and going, dude, I got a new lunch spot that we got to go to, right? And I'm telling people, because I love it. It's great. I found something. I want to share it with somebody. You do anything like that? You get the latest gadget and you just got to... so good. Our moms, you do something for the home that you find and you just got to tell every other lady, this is just incredible. You're an evangelist. I mean, you are. That's all it is. So back to the original question, is it well with your soul? Have you found peace with God? Have you received this love? If you have, oh, man, you've got something to share. Not cold, dead religion, but life. Jesus did something. He changed life. And here is an awesome message that the world is dying to hear. Verse 19, God is reconciling the world to Himself in Christ, not counting men's sins. Do you believe that? Because that's the heart of the gospel. And that doesn't get preached a lot in church because too many people are afraid of grace. If you tell people that, that's just going to give them a license to do whatever they want. And they can go out and just sin. That's the message of the gospel. I can't change that. You know, some people say that and they cloak it in religion. No, that's the heart of the gospel. Jesus died to forgive us of our sins. Take care of them. They're gone. Okay? It gives you not the license to sin. It gives you the liberty to live without guilt of what some religious person might think or say about you if you decide to follow Jesus. Think about that. Because it's when you start living like Jesus that the religious people go, why is that dude in the... Why did he go to the bar? And why is he... He goes to my church, my congregation, he's sitting at the bar talking to that guy, and they got a drink. What are they doing? Right? What did Paul say? Don't look at things from a worldly perspective. Think the best about your brother and sister until you know it's the worst. They may be with a brother or sister who they've been spending hours with in the workplace, listening to them, sharing, and they're just sitting there having conversation. And maybe that's a place for them to connect. Don't pass judgment in those moments. Otherwise, you'd be 2,000 years ago going, crucify him. What did they call him? Friend of sinners? Now listen, I'm not justifying crossing any line. There's some things that are very clear in the Scripture that are sin. Drunkenness is a sin. When you cross that line, you've crossed a line you never should cross. Okay? I want to make that very clear. But you should be like Jesus. And you should love people. And sometimes that'll take you places that are less comfortable for other people. If you're not comfortable, don't go into those places. Like mine, alcoholism, things like that, that's probably not the best place for you to go and be a witness. Okay? But we need to share this dying world. They need to hear this message. And unfortunately, the church, to a large degree, has forgot. The ministry of reconciliation is sharing that God's no longer counting men's sins against them once they receive His grace through Jesus, who died for those sins. And that's what the world needs to hear. That's why people are dying without that love. Last verse in closing. If I can find my... bring up the last verse so I can read it up there. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors as though God were appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made Him who had no sin to be sin for us so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. We're therefore Christ's ambassadors. What's an ambassador? A representative. So you're a representative of Jesus. So you come into a place like this and the pastor says, you're a representative of Jesus. Represent Jesus well. Don't drink, don't smoke, don't chew, don't go with girls or guys who do, right? You got to represent Him well. Because the people have to come in and see lives that are, you know, religiously spit-shined and just perfect, just right. Listen, you're Christ's ambassadors. You're His representatives. I'm His representative. Because my life needs to look like Jesus. And it didn't look all that spit shine and clean to the people around. His heart was pure. He never sinned. Ever. Never compromised. But man, he would be in the middle of a party with a bunch of sinners. So, what's it mean to be His ambassador? It means to live things that he did. What did Jesus do? He loved the marginalized. He loved the oppressed. The people that the world cast off, lepers, people with leprosy, people would cross on the other side of the road because that person was unclean. People wouldn't go near them. What does Jesus do purposely? He sees a leper and who's in need of healing, and Jesus could have just stay over here, be healed, and just keep on going. But what does he do? He walks over and does something that no one would ever do. And he puts his hands and just for a moment, we can't even understand this. Put yourself in the leper's shoes. Dejected, completely rejected by family, friends, nobody hear you. Haven't felt human touch in years and years. The Son of God comes over, puts his hands on you. And I think in that moment says, You're loved. See, that's what it's like to be an ambassador of Jesus. Don't look at people from a worldly perspective. Look at them the way God looks at them. Take time, spend time with people. You know, Jesus had one focus, and that was to do with the Father. He did the Father's will. He was about the Father's agenda. Sometimes we need to check our agenda at the door. I'm a pastor. Man, I got an agenda sometimes during the day. And when people have needs, sometimes, you know, we need to put aside our agenda. What's God's agenda in this? What does he want me to do? There's good news to be shared with the world. And I hope that all of us understand that. Listen, you need to stop asking forgiveness. If you're a believer in Jesus, you need to stop asking forgiveness for sins that you committed 5, 10, even a year ago. Why do you do that? I'll tell you why we do it. Because we don't believe that this is true. We don't believe that we're forgiven. We can't believe that God's so good that he would love me that. But he does. That's the message of the gospel. It's the good news. Now, he doesn't want you to stay there. So once you come out of that, receive that, move forward in him. Live for him. Free for him. To share the love that he wants you to share. God made him who had no sin to be us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. How could you ever take that for granted? How could you ever use that as a license to sin? It allows you to fall in love with God if you understand it. Sinner, separated from God, righteous in his sight. It doesn't make sense to me. I'll be the first one to say it. It doesn't make sense, but that is the truth. God sees you, he sees me, as righteous if we receive forgiveness and reconciliation through Jesus. It's the good news. Levi, if you guys will come back up. We're going to share communion in just a moment. And there's communion off to this side, there's communion off to this side, communion in the back. And in just a moment, we're going to worship for a few minutes, and there'll be plenty of time to have a moment to receive communion, maybe with someone around you, friend, family member. But this is a moment to remember the truth of what we're talking about today. Jesus' body was broken, his blood was shed for each one of us in this room, for everyone outside this room, people who would never walk into this room. My hope is that all of us stand that message and receive that love. And this is a reminder. And he said, when he sat with his best friends, you know, they sat around a table and they had a meal. It wasn't some sacrament on and some setting like this. They were eating a meal together. And he said, whenever you do this, remember me. And he took this bread and said, this is my body broken for you. This is the new covenant. It's a new covenant with God. Whenever you do this, remember me. So that's what I want us to do this morning. Remember Jesus. Remember what God has done through Jesus. If you would, stand with me. And we're going to sing in just a moment. But you sing just whenever you feel led. There'll be plenty of time. Feel led to come to one of the tables and just take that bread, break it, take that cup, take a moment. today. But I want to pray for all of us as we lead into this time. Let's pray. God, I pray that you would help us to believe and understand this message of the gospel. God, that you loved us so much. You willingly sent your Son to die for us. And God, as we receive love, as we receive that forgiveness, somehow your righteousness comes into us. And God, you would take people like us, the mess that we are in so many ways, and you share this message with the world. God, I pray that now, even as we sing, as we share this moment of communion, you would take our brokenness and be putting it back. Jesus, you were broken. Your blood was shed so that we wouldn't have to be. And so, God, we surrender to you now. In the midst of our pain, in the midst of our brokenness, God, we just say that we're yours. We thank you for the amazing grace that you extend to us. God, that you love us as we are, not as we should be. And we understand that we'll never be as we should be till the day we go to be with you. Help us to worship you from our hearts. And as you feel led, you can make your way to the communion tables.
Gather, men healed and whole, and see.
us to see you. As we're singing in that song, just to see you now. Look in. God, it's our desire to one day stand before you and hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant. And the reality is, many times we don't feel good, we don't feel faithful. But we thank you that Jesus was good and Jesus was faithful. And so in him we find life, and through him you see us, God. That scripture we read says you see us as righteous. We're the righteousness of God in Christ. And help us to see ourselves, God, with all the meaning and purpose that you created us with. God, that we wouldn't look at the world from an earthly perspective, that we would understand that all of life is spiritual. There's opportunities to interact in the spiritual realm right here, in these moments, with people in this room, as we leave in our home and at work. God, you want to use us. Forgive us for our blindness. Forgive us for allowing the noise of life to distract us, that we don't see those moments, God. It's my prayer that your spirit would break through more, that we'd be more sensitive to that. And God, as we are, we would be able to share that love that this desperately needs with the people around us, God. We thank you for it. And it's my prayer, God, that as we go from this place, that you would fill us with... God, you'd bring conviction to our hearts where we need conviction. If there's things we need to walk away from, we would walk away from those things. God, if we have to get over past our past and trust that in your hands, allow us to do that. God, give us the ability to know that we're forgiven. Help us to forgive ourselves, God. We'll live for you. So God, as we leave this place, I pray you'd fill my brothers and sisters with your spirit. God, that they would leave heads held high, sons and daughters of the Most High God, their righteousness found in Jesus, significance and purpose in him, a life and love to give to this world. May we go, and may we give it, and may we live it all for your glory, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God, peace be with you. We will see you soon. If anybody needs prayer, there'll be some of us over here. We'd love to pray with you about anything that's going on.
What I need is you to put me back.